stay, I bow to you. I feel the love in the sanctuary.
Feel the love in the sanctuary.
Lift your voice and repeat after me.
Good morning and welcome to Center for Spiritual Living, Greater Las Vegas. During this time before the Sunday celebration, we encourage you to let this music take you to a deeper place and allow yourself to be open and receptive to this morning's message.
Thank you. Yeah, let's give him a hand. That's Odyssey with Darren Motamedi, playing an original piece written by Darren called Namaste. So that's wonderful. Good morning. Look at you all right here, so bright and early. Welcome to Center for Spiritual Living on Daylight Saving Time. If you're just now arriving for our 9:15 meditation, welcome. We're just going to launch right into our celebration instead, but come on in. Anyway, so you are in a place that believes that the creator of all things is all that there is. It was all that there is in the beginning. It's all that there is now. I call it God. You can call it anything you want, but we believe that's all that exists. That means that you and I are perfect creations of that one, and we are awakening to that truth. Centers for Spiritual Living is a denomination that is working together and envisioning a world that works for everyone and for all of creation. And so we practice that here in so many ways. And then we go out into our lives and we shine this light in wonderful ways as well. So if you're here for the very first time, I want you to know that you are an absolutely welcome guest here this morning. I invite you to just open up your heart and your mind to something that is necessary for you to hear today. You are on a journey of awakening and you are absolutely welcome here at this stop on that journey. If you've come back for a second time, we're really grateful that something sparked in you and you're still checking it out. Maybe this will be a permanent thing for you, and we would love to have you join us on a regular basis. Those of us who are here a lot, welcome back. You have a connection card that you were given on the way in this morning. Please fill that out to the degree that you choose. Put the date and your name at least. If you're here for the first time, let us know who you are and how you found us, and we will seek ways to stay connected with you. If you're back a second time, let us know that as well. One of the things that we practice here are things called affirmations, short positive statements that even if we don't believe them, if we say them often enough, we begin to open to the possibility that they are true, and then they become true. So here's one. Say after me, praise God, it's a perfect day. I am so glad to be here. Life is good, and so it is. We just say that with enthusiasm or with terror, and guess what? They still have positive impacts all the way through. We love to sing in this community, and we're going to do that throughout the morning. The words that we sing, the songs that we sing together are up on the screen, so you can use that to guide yourself through. But if you're able, why don't you go ahead and stand up? We're going to sing this morning a song called I Am Blessed, and it's a peppy little thing, and it's going to be fun, and it goes something like this. Here we go.
I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day of my life, I am blessed, 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 blessed. When I wake up in the morning or lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed.
I am loved.
I am
yourself to people you don't know this morning. Thank you.
morning. Oh my gosh, it's awfully wonderful to see everybody. Hi. Well, we're moving into this morning's contemplation time. So please take your cell phone out. Check into Facebook. I already have. It's a beautiful day to celebrate life. Good time to check in. Then silence your cell phone. Or at least check to make sure it's silenced. Thank you. So let's begin with this week's affirmation from your program. It's also up there. You might choose to cut it out of your program. I like to either put mine up on the refrigerator or especially in the bathroom mirror, because that way I make sure I read it throughout the week. Actually, there's some that haven't ever gotten off because they're good ones to read. And that reminds you of your truth of your being. So ready? Today and for all time, I choose to move beyond self-imposed obstacles and aimless wanderings to travel a clear path of spiritual unfoldment. Take a deep breath and let the music carry you into meditation, a moment of silence, after which I'll do the invocation.
As I say a tender yes to everything that comes to me, my heart is open, I am free. I open to all that is, it brings me to my I surrender, I am peace. As I say a tender yes to everything that comes to me, my heart is open, I am free. To all that is, it brings me to my knees. I surrender, I am peace. I
I invite you to remain silent, to simply breathe in spirit, to breathe in God, to breathe in that life, the love, the peace, the understanding and clarity, the wisdom, the supply, all of which is God, is Spirit, is Source itself. It is so wondrous when I recognize the power, the presence, the life is continuously and eternally available. That the power is right here in this moment. That creative power is right here in this moment for me. For all. And I'm so grateful that I have this time, this place, this community to celebrate this awareness. That all is in divine right order. That everything I have experienced, if it was a mistake, it's a time for learning. If it's an injustice, a powerful time for me to grow and strengthen. Knowing that the light of God is ever present, always available. And so in this time of celebration, this time of coming together to be inspired, to learn, to grow spiritually, it is absolutely wonderful, marvelous, that I have this magnificent time. And in this gratitude, and knowing that all is well, and everything proceeds today in perfect harmony and balance, I simply say, and so it is.
Are too. Like every time I come here, I mean, you guys are incredible. Every time I come here, I just am so happy. It's like an awesome band. You guys are amazing. So, thank you so much. Doug is amazing. It's just wonderful. Mary, you're amazing. Thank you.
What was the name of that song? You're incredible. You're incredible. You're incredible. Melvin was just like, thank you. Wow, that was pretty awesome. This month's theme, spiritual living through education and continuous improvement. Sounds kind of dry, but can you imagine having a value that says, I'm going to, every day of my life, I'm dedicated to improving continuously. Getting better and better as I go. That means there's no end to it. That's why we have people of all, you know, beginning from the earliest moments through the latest moments in life that are enthused and engaged and active in these centers, because we are so into the idea that there is always more to grow into, more to grow into the authentic human being that we are as a creation of God. Webs and Boxes, a mysterious title that I will get into and describe a little bit later, but generally that's how women and men experience this thing differently, and yet this thing is what serves in all of us pretty much to destroy our being, who we truly are, which is perfect creations of God. So it's not going to be really a bummer, but it's going to get into some areas where you might feel some resonance and maybe haven't heard, maybe ever spoken publicly about. So I'm going to talk more about that in a moment, but what I want to
just address broadly this morning is this idea of realizing who we truly are, creations of God, and therefore perfect, which is a lifelong practice. Absolutely, that's true. But as we do that, as we realize who we truly are, that automatically creates a fulfilled and satisfying life. It automatically happens that way. And, or but, depending on how you hear this, in order to do that, we are called to be authentic and vulnerable. Vulnerable. So, that's what I'm going to be talking about this morning. And a lot of this material comes from our book this month called Daring Greatly, Brené Brown. And forgive me for this piece of it. I'm going to read from the book. I know that most adults hate being read to. And this is her point of view. It's concise and it's clear. And this is what she is talking about in this book and what I want to address this morning. She said, "When we spend our lives waiting until we are perfect or bulletproof before we walk into the arena, we ultimately sacrifice relationships and opportunities that may not be recoverable. We squander our precious time, and we turn our backs on our gifts, those unique contributions that only we can make. Perfect and bulletproof are seductive, but they don't exist in the human experience. They don't exist. There is no perfection. There is no being completely invulnerable. We must walk into the arena, whatever that arena may be, a new relationship, an important meeting, our creative process, a difficult family conversation. We must walk in with courage and the willingness to engage. Rather than sitting on the sidelines and hurling judgment and advice, we must dare to show up and let ourselves be seen. This is vulnerability. This is daring greatly. Let ourselves be seen in the fullness of who we are." So basically what she's saying to me and to all of us is tell the truth. Show up and tell the truth. And sometimes we say, that's my truth. And in this faith, we talk about the truth, which is true everywhere. And I'm looking at this from both perspectives, because tell the truth about who you are, both as a creation of God and a being walking around on this earthly experience. Tell the truth. There's an absolute nature to us that is never absent. The divine center of us that is always true, that divine center that we know and we are aware of in our clearest moments, and the relative experience that we have walking around here on planet Earth can sometimes cloud that divine reality, right? Yeah, sometimes. We carry both with us. We carry the divine truth, which has never gone from us, and then we also have this relative experience that we have on Earth, and we forget. We forget this divine reality. And it is that disconnect that I want to talk about this morning. A disconnect between what our faith tells us, what we know in our clearer or higher moments, and what our current felt experience is. And it seems to me that it's really, really important that we have places or people where or with whom we can share that felt reality, that felt experience in that moment, where we can share that disconnect to be real with where we are. Even if we know in the depths of us that this isn't the truth, the eternal truth, that this too shall pass, to have a place or a person where or with whom we can share where we are right now is really, really important. So in your life this morning, where does what's out picturing not match the image you thought it should be or were told it should be? Is there a place that pops immediately to mind? I think we all have those areas where it's like, this is the ideal and this is the reality, and they're not the same. I know God is all there is. I know God is love and God is peace, and I still allow myself to get angry while I'm driving. That's a disconnect. That's dissonance. That doesn't match the image that I think I should have out there, right? So do you have some place or someone with whom you can give voice to that? Just to that reality. This is what's happening for me right now. Maybe it's not that scenario, you know, where the inside picture doesn't match the outside. Maybe it's some other area where you have a judgment against yourself that you're not doing it right. Whatever that area is, that's what we want to talk about. If it's a physical thing, if it's a relationship thing, maybe something professional. That's what we want to look at in bridging that seeming disconnect and then having a more empowered life so that we can return to acknowledging and realizing who it is that we truly are. So in Daring Greatly, Brené Brown says that we are hardwired for connection, love, and belonging. We are hardwired for connection, love, and belonging. That sounds right to me. Hardwired for connection, love, and belonging. She says it's why we are here, and it is what gives purpose and meaning to our lives. That idea of connection, that idea of love. So one of the main foci of the book, then, is what gets in the way of that connection, what gets in the way of that love, what gets in the way of that belonging. And it's called shame. Shame. Now, she describes or defines shame in this way, and I'm going to put it up on the screen too because, I mean, it's kind of long, but it's the fear of disconnection. It's the fear that something we've done or failed to do, an ideal that we've not lived up to, or a goal that we have not accomplished, makes us unworthy of that connection that we are hardwired for. Something we've done or failed to do, an ideal that we haven't lived up to, or a goal that we've not accomplished. She says it's also the intensely painful feeling or experience of believing that we are flawed and therefore unworthy of love and belonging. That our flaws make us unworthy of love and belonging. Now, she makes a clear distinction very early on in the book between guilt and shame. Shame is not guilt. Guilt says, I did something bad, while shame says, I am bad. Do you feel the difference? I mean, we say here we don't do guilt either. But I did something bad versus I am bad. An action versus a state of being. That's powerful. So shame says, I am unworthy of whatever fulfillment or connection because of my defect, because of that flaw that I have. Now, there's a lot of people sitting right and listening, I hope, and if you think that this isn't relevant to you, I want you to just kind of take a breath and take a beat and consider this. Brené Brown is not some new age, you know, tree hugger. She's a PhD, she's a multiple PhD, she is a research scientist, and she has done the research that resulted in this book over a period of 12 years with interviews. And this idea of shame has three universal truths. First, we all have it. We all have it. And as I'm reading through the book, I'm thinking, is this, you know, do I want to push it away or is this true for me? And there, yes, we all have it. We're all afraid to talk about it. And then to multiply and make it worse, the less we talk about it, the more it controls us. So do you see the conundrum? We're afraid to talk about it because we think we might be the only one. But we all have it. And the more afraid we are to talk about it, the less we talk about it, the more it has power over our lives. And that is what is hiding the true us from ourselves and from the world. The true us as fully functioning creative expressions of God. And that's who we are, and that's what we can realize. Brené Brown began this research only with women. She's a really powerful writer. She's so real. And she said, frankly, I think it's because I didn't even want to approach the idea of men with this. I knew it would be a completely foreign experience, and I didn't want to get into it. But as things worked out and as the divine path unfolded, she was very clearly meant to do this with men as well. So she did both. And what she came to understand is that, yes, we all experience shame. We're all afraid to talk about it, and the less we talk about it, the more it controls us. But as she got clearer and clearer as the years went by and she coded and collated the data, she began to understand that though we all experience shame, men and women broadly and in general feel it or process it differently. And that's an important thing that she found out. So for women, feeling unworthy or not enough or the fear of disappointing someone becomes like a web. A very sticky, she calls it a complex spider web of layered, conflicting, and competing expectations about what and who and how they should be as a woman. This very sticky, complex web. And every move to free yourself as a woman from that web just gets you more stuck. Because the choices that you make have consequences, or the choice that you're making is going to disappoint someone. And so you just feel more and more stuck in this web. And as she did her began her research with men and went further and further with it, not feeling enough or feeling unworthy or fear of disappointing someone as a man becomes like a box, being crunched inside a box. A box that has very clear rules about who, how, and what one should be as a man in the world. And for men, she found it fascinating, but the rule, the main rule always is some variation of this. Don't be weak. Don't be weak. There's a lot of other ways that you can say that, and she just lays it right out there in the book. I won't repeat them on a Sunday morning. But it is very, very clear that for men, it's like vulnerability, authenticity. No, that's weakness. Admitting your flaws, hell no. So what she says is that men and women then become like the wizard at the end of The Wizard of Oz, you know, the guy behind the curtain who is doing all sorts of fantastic things to detract from who he really is. And so he's putting on these displays of either awesomeness or power or might so that nobody will see the true him, the vulnerable, flawed, imperfect person that he actually is. It's terrifying and it's exhausting to put on that show. And how many of us put on that show? It's like, I'm going to do this mad dance center stage so you don't see me cowering in the corner over here, afraid that I'm going to say something wrong or be something that you don't want me to be. It's exhausting. So happily, you know, Brené Brown has done this, and she has lived this. She lives her research, and then she applies it to herself. It's kind of amazing. And she has announced and is writing about a way through this. How do we move through this experience of shame so that we can get to the true connection and love that we desire, that we are hardwired for? So to live an empowered and expansive life, she says the way through it is to experience empathy. To experience empathy. To have someone respond to our story when we are sharing who we truly are in that moment or how we're feeling. To have someone respond with love and understanding. With empathy. She says, in the face of true empathy, shame vanishes. It cannot survive. It begins to weaken when we start to tell our story, when we start to tell our truth. But if we are in the presence of someone or if we are in some situation where there is true empathy, where there is real understanding happening, then shame cannot exist. Tell me if this is something you've experienced in your life, because I sure have a lot. I am with somebody I care about. They are maybe sharing a difficult time in their life. They're having a difficult moment. They are telling their truth, but sharing who they really are in that moment, their vulnerability. And what happens in me, my heart opens up to them. And it is this idea of vulnerability, of being authentic with each other, even in the difficult moments, is such a connection maker. And that connection is what we're wired for. Have you ever experienced that with someone? They've opened up to you and your heart just opens to them. You feel so connected. But here's the irony of that experience. Even though many of us have experienced that, are you the first one to open up yourself and be authentic and vulnerable in front of somebody else? Oh, hell no, right? It's terrifying. I don't want to do that. I don't want them to see the real me. I want them to see the me that they think I am, that I want them to think I am, that I think I want them to think I am. Whatever, right? It's scary. It's scary to do that, but if we want to work toward a world that works for everyone, we've got to start doing that. And yes, there will be some people that you maybe open up to that can't handle the degree of realness you're bringing. That can happen. Everybody's on their own path and their own journey. But there's something that's become very, very clear to me again, and I had thought of this before, but reading this book and then looking at my life, just because something is scary, just because something that I'm about to face or do is scary, does not make it bad or mean that I shouldn't do it. In fact, it might be the very clue that I should do it. Look at this. Look how very close scared is to sacred. Those moments of opening up, of being real, not in a way to do damage or harm to someone, but to say, here's where I am right now. This is who I am right now. That is making a connection. That is experiencing empathy and love. That is something that we are hardwired for. So in the past week or two, I have had several sacred moments happen that were pretty scary because they were requiring me to be authentic, to be vulnerable with who and where I was in that moment. And yet doing so established a connection that otherwise wouldn't have been here. You know, I think this faith's teachings can sometimes be used to our own detriment, right? Because we are taught, rightfully so, up to a point, to turn away from any undesirable condition, stop giving it energy, so that we may bring something more desirable into our experience through the creative process. Turn away from something undesirable. And sometimes we do that in a way that is not healthy. We are denying, I am not feeling this. And yet every ounce of our energy is focused on that feeling of shame or that we're disappointing someone or something like that. And so she cautions in this book for us to make sure that we're not bypassing. Oftentimes you'll hear people say, I think I just did a spiritual bypass. You know, I'm ignoring something that's, I'm not really turning away from it. I'm ignoring it and it's there. We may be bypassing something that could be really important to address, that could do some really wonderful healing work and building connection and bridges if we just are honest and authentic and, yes, vulnerable with where we might be in that moment. To live a deeply fulfilling life, we've got to be willing to share the truth of who and where we are in the moment, in some place safe, of course. So if you have landed on something when I asked the question this morning where you are trapped in the web or caught in the box of shame, then seek that place or that person with whom you can begin to share that. It cannot live. It begins to weaken the minute you start sharing it, and it cannot survive in the face of true empathy. And it's entirely possible, yes, that somebody may not be able to make that connection with you, and that's okay. There are others who can. If you are truly seeking that experience, you'll find it. It's available to everyone. Find someone who will hear you with true love and understanding. You know, if we want to create a world that works for everyone and for all of creation, you and I have to stop putting on personas we think the world wants to see. It's not real. It's like the Wizard of Oz. It might be awesome to look at, but that's it. It's shallow. It's vacant. It's empty. It's hollow. So daring to be authentic, being willing to disengage from the web or climb out of the box of shame, it elevates us. It doesn't elevate us above anybody else, but it elevates us, ourselves, into a life that is chock full of love and connection and belonging. So the question for you this week, for me, is, are you willing to head there? Are you willing to head to love and connection and belonging? Are you willing? Yes. All right. There's probably a list in the lobby, but okay. So if so, then let's start with some affirmations. Just a little practice to send us off on our week this morning. All that I am, and all I will ever be, is a perfect expression of God. All that I am, and all that I will ever be, is a perfect expression of God. Therefore, I am enough. I am enough. And my life matters. And so it is. Namaste. Thank you. All right. Untangle from the web. Break out of the box. All right. So thank you for that. We're going to move in just a few moments into the sharing of our tithes and offerings. But first, we have a guest with us, and I want to bring Michael Shalaba up and to introduce our guest. Michael Shalaba, our Director of Local Outreach, is going to introduce our partner representative this month, and we'll hear from him. Hi, Michael.
Hello. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How are we? Awesome. So first, I would like to thank all the volunteers that came out for the Ronald McDonald House last month. Show of hands, who was there? All right, so we have some people here. We had over 20 volunteers, and we baked cookies, we cleaned the house, did a lot of things, so it was a lot of fun. So thanks again for coming out. This week, our outreach project is with Three Square, It's going to be this coming Saturday, the 18th, from 9:30 to 11:30. We will be meeting here at the center at 8:45 and leaving here at 9 if you want to carpool. If you want to go directly to 3 Square, you can do that as well. I will be in the courtyard after service to get anyone signed up who's interested. And what I'd like to do is invite Matt Hirsch up to offer him our donation and have him talk about what 3 Square does and what we'll be doing on Saturday when we go out to volunteer. So, Matt.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Wow, thank you, Michael. Doug, I'm speechless. I have to say that the messages I've heard today resonate so deeply with me. I really feel speechless. God is, I am blessed. I mean, these are things that I feel. In my life and in my vocation and in the fact that I have the opportunity to work with 3 Square. So I'm here today to invite you to join us next Saturday to volunteer there. And I wanted to say a few things about this and how much it harmonizes with the messages I'm hearing today, particularly connection, love, and belonging. So we have in our community in Southern Nevada close to 300,000 brothers and sisters who are at risk of hunger, who really don't aren't sure where their next meal is going to come from, either on a daily or a weekly or monthly basis. So that's our job at 3 Square. And when I say our job, I mean it's the community's job. 3 Square is a community organization. It is the product of this community. So it is supported by this community, and it is sustained by people like everyone here, all of us, to make it work. So that's what I love about 3 Square, is what happens there is the community comes together to feed ourselves, our own, our brothers and sisters. So I feel like I have the best job in the world, and I truly mean that. In order to make that happen, to ensure that 300,000 people, over half of whom, by the way, are children or at least minors, kids under the age of 18. So we come together every day, 6 days a week there, to pack food and distribute it throughout Southern Nevada for people who need it. And just to give you a sense of the scale and kind of where we are at this point, this year in 2017, with the help of the community, volunteers, we will distribute 42 million pounds of food in 2017. So if you do the math, we are distributing, on average, about 75 tons of food a day, every day, to 600 locations. So we have a huge transportation team. I love our drivers. They're our ambassadors. They're out there in refrigerated trucks and tractor trailers, literally distributing 75 tons of food every single day to hundreds of locations, mostly here in Las Vegas and Clark County, but far and wide. Wherever someone is hungry, we are delivering food. Tiny towns out there, all over Southern Nevada. We deliver food to populations of 800 people. And so it's something that we are very proud of. We love it. And it's something this community can be proud of because it is purely sustained by this community. Last year, over 30,000 volunteers came through our doors, 6 days a week, morning, afternoon, and evenings, to make sure that that food got packed. We cannot do it alone. We're a small team, actually, those of us who work at 3 Square. So I'll give you an example. So our kitchen, we have a beautiful, huge community kitchen that produces something like 16,000 meals every single day. That takes about 90 volunteers every day between the morning and afternoon to pack those fresh meals for hungry kids. Those are delivered at 230 schools every single morning at 5 a.m. out of our refrigerator, which is about the size of this room. And so it's a beautiful thing. So where connection and love and belonging come in, and where I feel so blessed is, so imagine those numbers I mentioned. So approximately 1,200 people come through our doors every week, flowing into our kitchen, produce packing, a large room where we just pack thousands of pounds of fresh fruits and vegetables every single day, little 5-pound bags, because everything we deliver for every program, whether it's for children, seniors, or just families that are struggling to make ends meet, everybody is getting fresh fruits and vegetables, along with either a meal prepared in our kitchen or groceries that are assembled, bagged up, or boxed up out in our warehouse on multiple assembly lines. So those of you who come out next Saturday, and I really encourage you to see it and feel it, because I always say, you know, these are just numbers. You really have to be there to experience this. People leave dancing out the door of this place, because what you feel there is connection, love, and belonging, I assure you. We are an all-inclusive community. We are led by a God-centered CEO. And so we know every day that the reason we're there and the reason we're blessed to be there is to help feed our neighbor, our brother, our sister. And you will feel that, I assure you. So when you come in next Saturday, those of you who choose to come out, we ordinarily on a Saturday have about 200 volunteers. This coming Saturday is kind of one of our super Saturdays, we call it. We'll actually have about 400 volunteers there. We'll be operating out of both buildings, running about 10 to 12 different activities. Everything that a volunteer touches there, every piece of fruit, every meal that they prepare will be distributed, will be delivered to someone who needs that within days. We are moving food through there so fast, it would make your head spin. So volunteers from here will likely be out in our what we call our North Warehouse, either packing assembly line fashion bags of groceries for families or children or boxes of groceries for senior citizens. We will be running all of those activities on Saturday, along with fresh meals in our kitchen, a variety of other things. And anyone who shows up, I encourage you to identify yourself to me. We love showing people around, so either just before or after your activity, I can give you kind of, you know, a quick tour of the place. But it's quite amazing to be a part of 400 people coming together. The village truly comes together on Saturdays to feed our own. We play music, it's fun, people get to meet each other. We never turn away a volunteer. That's where the belonging comes in. We are all inclusive. We have special needs groups coming in every single morning to help do vitally needed tasks to ensure that our community is fed. So it's a beautiful gathering place for people of all walks of life to come together and help feed our community. So I do hope that that you will join us next Saturday. I won't take up any more of your time. I can't tell you how thankful we are for the contribution. I forgot, I wasn't expecting this. So I'm going to share this with you. $300 is really huge for us. And at Three Square, we operate in a very streamlined fashion, and we are very transparent and very vulnerable, actually, at our team meetings, our managers' meetings. We cry, we laugh, we tell stories about things we've heard out in the field, people who needed that food. But $300 is 900 meals. And so that's the impact that you've made with your contribution. Our finances are absolutely transparent. Every dollar contributed to Three Square equals three meals that we're able to provide to people who need it in this community. It's simply by the numbers. So I thank you very, very much.
Matt, you said it would make our heads spin. My head already is spinning. So it's an enormous operation, and you're a powerful spokesman for that. And thank you for integrating what I said into what you said. He was listening. I love people who listen. So I hope you get that what you give here makes a difference. Your treasure and your time, it makes a difference in the world. It makes a difference here. So I encourage you and invite you to continue that journey of opening up to giving more. So we're going to do that now. We're going to enter into our giving of our tithes and offerings. We do this as a very conscious spiritual practice, along with prayer and meditation and service and study. We give consciously of our treasure knowing that this is the substance of the divine. It is infinite in origin and possibility, and we give in expanded ways and watch as the universe responds. So giving and receiving, part of the same energy. Our prosperity acceptors are stepping forward. They've been giving all morning, and now they are receiving from us. We give, and then we receive from the band. It's just a wonderful circulation thing. Hold your gift somewhere near your heart. Give it a silent, powerful blessing, and then we'll send it on its way. And so it is. Something they worked up for us. Oh, right on. You know what? I'd like some quiet music under this, if we could, just meditative kind of stuff. So you were handed these when you came in. If you're part of this congregation over the last 6 weeks, you know what we're doing now. This is a global time sponsored by the Association for Global New Thought called the Season for Nonviolence. And it is an opportunity for us over a period of 60, how many days? Oh, well, we're just handing you another check that somebody has written to you for another 300 meals. Thank you. That's awesome. I think it's 62 days, the Season for Nonviolence, something like that. It weighs 64. For us to work together to create a world that works for everyone. How can we practice nonviolence more in the world? And so for the month of March, we have something on the purple slip that I want you to just contemplate for now. Where in your mind or heart are you judging? And I would maybe even suggest this morning, where are you judging yourself as less than, as unworthy, as, you know, fearful of disappointing someone? And if maybe you can be ready to let go of that. So I want you to take in a deep breath and close your eyes and just contemplate that. Where in my heart or mind am I judging? Where am I carrying judgment against myself or another? And in light of this morning and this powerful day, is there a willingness in me to release that judgment? So if something shows up where you are going to choose to release that today, I invite you to open your eyes and write that down. And once you write it down on the purple slip, you can fold it so you don't ever have to see it again. And when you leave the double doors at the back this morning, there's a red bowl. Drop it in the red bowl. Our Global Heart Connection International Outreach Ministry will do some prayer with those slips. They won't read them. They'll just pray. And then they will set them aflame and let them disappear. That's the symbolic releasing that we're doing. So the purple slip, you get rid of. The green one, you can keep. Because once we release something that has limited our experience, there's more room in our consciousness, in our being, to embrace something greater, a more life-enhancing experience. This one, for this month, is forgiveness. Maybe the releasing of judgment allows you then to forgive yourself or another. Perhaps that's where you will embrace forgiveness, if there's some place or something in your life that you'd like to remind yourself you're going to practice forgiveness. Write that down and keep this with you this week as an opportunity for you to practice different forms of nonviolence that can help create the bridges, the connection, and maybe, yes, even the sense of belonging that we're all seeking. So taking a deep breath, just let go of that. Thanks, Melvin. So before we end with prayer, we have just a few announcements this week. So again, bring in your books, your tapes, if you have any of those left, and CDs that you're willing to put back into circulation. Our Global Heart Connection will be selling all of those things. The first two Sundays of April, all of the proceeds will go to the Nairobi Center for Spiritual Living in Kenya. So that's our opportunity to support them in ways that are also good for us. We can read something or hear something new to us. I've been talking about the book Daring Greatly all month. It's in the bookstore for 20% off. In our bookstore, you don't pay sales tax, so that's already, what, 8-point-something discount, no shipping. So good deal over there in the bookstore. It's an amazingly powerful read. This coming Wednesday is our Wednesday evening service. Reverend Claire Summerhill will be facilitating that, and she is titling it Ready for Miracles, Opening Ourselves to God's Good. And she always has a wonderful, often humorous take on the teaching and the theme for the month, so she's going to be here at 7 o'clock. We have an hour of dinner, soup, and other things beforehand from 5:30 to 6:30. You pay $1 a bowl, and you can have a wonderful homemade soup or something else that has been prepared. If you can do that for them, if you can bring something, a soup or anything else that you'd like to share for a meal on Wednesday night, please do that. They would be thrilled to accept your donation. Again, Michael, will you have the sign-up sheet with you for this for next Saturday? Okay, so he'll be out in the courtyard. Sign up with Michael this morning for the volunteer day next Saturday. And then finally, next Sunday, we get to experience another wonderful luncheon from our Global Heart Connection. It's a St. Patrick's Day brunch. Adults will be $10, $5 for anyone under 12. And you know that Every single dollar that they raise at these luncheons does go to support not only the center in Nairobi, but also the Science of Mind School there in the slum, which is doing magnificent work. By the way, their Cares Closet had a garage sale last weekend. We were announcing it. They had an intention to raise $1,000 from that garage sale to go to buy school uniforms. They want every kid in the school to have a uniform. They actually made $1,100. So congratulations to them for that clear intention. Oh yeah, so next Sunday is St. Patrick's Day. I think we've got something to watch about that.
Chip. Chip.
I know.
I'm looking over a four-leaf clover that I overlooked before. One leaf is sunshine, the second is rain. The third is the roses that grow in the lane. No need explaining, the one remaining is somebody I adore. I'm looking over a four-leaf clover that I overlooked before. I'm looking over a four-leaf clover that I overlooked before. The one leaf is sunshine, the second is rain. The third is the roses that grow in the lane. The one remaining is somebody I have saw. I'm looking over a four-leaf clover that I overlooked before. I am a something I overlooked before.
Yes. St. Patrick's Day this week. Luncheon next weekend. All right, so we're going to end our service time this morning in prayer. I would like our ministry of prayer to stand and surround our space, our ministry of prayer, the ministers and practitioners who are licensed to serve here, our members here. We are pledged every day to pray, to sit in affirmative spiritual mind treatment for and with you. If you have specific requests, you have a connection card, you can write it on the back of that. You can drop a card in the prayer box in the lobby, or send an email to the Ministry of Prayer. We're happy to address specific requests. After the service, in fact, you can get private or personal one-on-one prayer with a practitioner in the prayer room. That is an instantaneous way to receive that support. But this here is a demonstration of what we're doing every day. Know that we surround you with our love and our consciousness in prayer every single day of the week. So taking a deep breath with me. And let the breath out. If it is your custom to close your eyes in spiritual practice, I invite you to do that. And as I began this morning talking about affirmations, this form of prayer is affirmative. It is a string of affirmations grounded in what is spiritually true. And what is spiritually true anywhere is true everywhere. That's what we mean when we say truth in spiritual terms. And so it is easy to know that the truth is that God is all there is. There's only one. One creator, one intelligence, one presence, one essence, one substance, one power. In the beginning, God created. So the beginning of time and space and God's creation of it happened at the same moment. In that first instant of creation, God already existed. So the Creator exists beyond time and space, and yet fills every moment, every aspect of creation, because it brought forth the universe from its own substance. There was nothing else but God for this universe to be created from. And so this universe, as it continues to expand, is expanding into the infinite. It is becoming more like its creator. And that is true for me, and that is true for each one here, and all who ever hear these words. That value of continuous improvement, of lifelong expansion, that is the microcosm of the universe, which is the microcosm of God, expanding into the infinite. And so I claim for myself and for each of us a willingness to be authentic, to speak truth, and to make that connection, to find ourselves in a space or with another with whom we can experience that connection of love and understanding, where we can be real, where we feel that sense of belonging. However fleeting it might be, it is truth, and it's real, and it's powerful. And I'm so grateful to have this community to practice this kind of connection, to feel it so powerfully, and to know that it strengthens and empowers and guides beyond these walls. And as we feel it and experience it here, we can then share it in the rest of our lives, building those bridges of connection and understanding, truly working toward a world that works for everyone, starting right here, right now. And so I give thanks for this community, for this teaching, for the presence of the One within and around us all, and for this sacred experience. I give thanks. And as I give thanks for all of this, I can let go now. I can release into that divine creative energy that is God, that knows how to create anything. We have given it the shape and form, and the substance of the One is now filling it, creating it into time, into form, into experience for us, as us, and through our acceptance. And so I release into that with gratitude, knowing that it is done right here and right now. And we let it go together by saying, and so it is.
I am letting go of the things that no longer serve me. As I'm letting go, God's revealed and I am whole. I am letting go of the things that no longer serve me. As I'm letting go, God's revealed and I am whole. I am letting go of the things that no longer serve me. As I'm letting go, God's revealed and I am whole.
All right, we're going to finish on our feet. If that's possible, go ahead and stand up. We're going to sing, I Release.
I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life, and my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here for God. No more struggle, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the Spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life, and my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here for God. No more struggle, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the Spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God.
Side of you, take a hand. We connect hand to hand and heart to heart. Please say after me, something wonderful is happening as me right now.
Something wonderful is happening as me right now.
It is this thing called life.
It is this thing called life.
Life is in my mind.
Life is in my mind.
Life is in my body.
Life is in my body.
Life is in everything I do.
Life is in everything I do.
I am it.
I am
I receive it.
I receive it.
I share it.
I share
and
it.
I accept it. Just the way that it is, and
just the way that it is to be.
Thank you, life.
Thank you, life.
Amen.